Hello everyone, I welcome you to my YouTube channel Professor Civil Mandal. Here I speak about civil engineering and you will find my various video lectures regarding various topics of civil engineering over here. So this is the second video of this particular course and also this is the second chapter which deals with precipitation. And precipitation, as you know, is one of the phenomenon which we come through in the hydrological cycle. And it is actually an important phenomenon in various hydrological aspects. If you just see the various hydrological aspects, you will see that precipitation comes to a very important role, and it has a very important role in various hydrological activities, whatever we are counting on. So precipitation, as you know, is the water released from clouds in the form of rain, freezing rain, sleet, snow or hail. It is primary connection in the water cycle that provides for the delivery of atmospheric water to the earth. So about this particular definition of precipitation, we have read it in the first chapter in the previous video, where there we read about the introduction of hydrology, and there we read about the hydrological cycle, and this particular definition came out when we were reading about the precipitation. So I had already told you that in the last video that precipitation is of many types, like you are seeing in the definition, like sleet, snow or hail. It's not like that only rainfall or only snowfall is the one method of precipitation. So four, five or six methods are there related to precipitation. So about them, rainfall comes the first one. And as you know, one more thing, that the precipitation is the primary connection in the water cycle that provides for the delivery of atmospheric water to the earth. So maybe the precipitation is the primary and the only way the atmospheric water comes to the surface of the earth, and most of it is taken up by the rainfall. Rainfall is one type of precipitation where the rain is the liquid water in the form of droplets that have condensed from the atmospheric water vapor and then become heavy enough to fall under gravity. So the gravity has an important role in precipitation, especially for rainfall. So whenever the water droplets that are being condensed from the water vapors which are evaporated from various sources, those condensed heavier water droplets actually become heavy enough to fall to the earth's surface under the action of gravity. So that gravity plays an important role, and also the weight of those particular droplets, and therefore you can say that rainfall is one of the heaviest form of precipitation. So again, this rainfall can be classified according to their intensity as light, medium and heavy. So first of all, the rainfall denotes the water droplets ranging from 0.5 to 6 mm. So the water droplets which are of size 0.5 to 6.7. So if you are having a particular precipitation at your area and you are assuming that the water droplets are ranging from 0.5 to 6 mm, then you can say that your place is experiencing rainfall at that time. You cannot say it is some other form like drizzle or snow or glaze. Okay, so according to intensity, rainfall is again divided as light, medium and heavy. So light rainfall, if the intensity of rainfall is 0 to 2.5 millimeter per hour. So if the intensity of rainfall is from 0 to 2.5 millimeter for a particular hour, millimeter per hour is the unit in which the intensity of rainfall is being measured. So for 0 to 2.5 millimeter per hour, we can say that, we can classify that this particular rainfall is a light rainfall. But when that intensity is from 2.5 to 7.5, we can say that it is a medium type of rainfall, and when it is greater than 7.5, we will say that it's a heavy rainfall for that particular place. So heavy rainfall is mostly seen in the monsoon period, that is in the month of June, July and August for subcontinental countries like India and Sri Lanka and Pakistan, whatever are there. And also, after rainfall, there is one more kind of precipitation, that is snowfall, in the form of ice crystals of density 0.1 gram
per cc. So the ice crystals which are of 0.1 gram per cc, they can also fall in the form of precipitation, and these are known as the snowfall, and it occurs only in those places where the temperature is very low and it is actually below the freezing point, like in the hilly areas, in the mountainous areas like Himalaya, or some cold countries like the European countries like Greenland or England or Ireland, some countries like that, they experience the snowfall where you will see a very cold climate is there. Next is the drizzle. Drizzle is the fine droplets of size less than 0.5 mm. So whenever the rainfall, as you know, that rainfall is from size 0.5 to 6 mm. But if the size is anyhow lesser than 0.5 mm, then we call it as drizzle. So drizzle is one kind of rainfall whose droplets are very fine, less than 0.5 mm, and the intensity is also less than 1 mm per hour. So you can see that intensity is also very light and the size of the droplets are also very light. So drizzle is some another form of precipitation. We cannot directly say that it is rainfall, but we will say yeah, it is some other form of precipitation where we see such droplets and such intensity of rainfall. Next is the glaze, the droplets of water converting to ice as soon as they come in contact to ice. So it is the droplets of water converting to ice. So this happens whenever rainfall comes in very proximity or very close to some surface which is very cold, which is very freezing, below the freezing point. And due to that, what happens, the rain droplets which fall, they actually convert to the ice form, that is to the solid form, as and when they reach very close to that cold zone or the cold surface on the earth. So this thing is known as a glaze. Previously they started to fall as droplets of water, but later on they are converting to ice just before they fall on the ground surface. So next is the sleet, and the frozen raindrop of transparent nature is known as a sleet. So this is another form of precipitation. And next is the hail, that is the lumps of ice of size less than 8 mm. So sometimes you will see during the rainfall, or just after the rainfall, or just after the rainfall, you may see that some big chunks of ice of size like 8 mm. 8 mm is too high. Like suppose the raindrops are of size 6 mm, but those chunks are of size 8 mm. So such big chunks of ice, some lumps of ice which are dropping from the atmosphere in form of precipitation, these are known as the hailstones. So this form of this form of precipitation is also known as the hail. And if it is very heavy in intensity, then we call it a hailstorm. Okay, so this was all about the different types of precipitation. And now we will move on to the next topic, that is the rainfall measurement. So in this particular topic, what we are going to do is that we will read about the various processes that we come across, or the various methods which the meteorologist or the hydrologist apply to measure the rainfall of a particular place or a particular catchment. So about the catchment which we read in the previous video lecture on the introduction to hydrology, and in a particular catchment, if that is my study area, the rain gauges are kept. Rain gauge is the only instrument that can be used. Okay, and these are used by the meteorologist and the hydrologist to gather and measure the amount of liquid precipitation over an area. So mainly the liquid form of precipitation is taken care of. Like if it is a rainfall or if it is a drizzle, then only we can take the measure using the rain gauge, not for the case of for a snowfall or for a glaze or sleet. So for the liquid form of precipitation only we apply this thing known as this instrument known as the rain gauge, and this is used by meteorologists and hydrologists to gather the information of that particular catchment area. So the rainfall is the predominant form of precipitation. So you know that rainfall is the predominant form of precipitation, and mostly this thing is measured in the rain gauges. So what I am going to do is now that as this thing doesn't require much explanation, and this thing is quite simple. If you just go through it, will be very easy to understand. It is written in a very simple languages. So what I will do, I will just do some thorough reading about these particular sections of different types of rain gauges, and I will show you the diagrams. So as we can quickly move on to the next topic, that is the optimum number of rain gauges. So first of all, the rain gauges can be of two types. One is the non-recording type rain gauge, and second one is the recording type rain gauges. So these are the two types of rain gauges, and the non-recording type rain gauge, its example is the Simon's rain gauge. Simon is the scientist who developed this particular rain gauge, and therefore it's known as the Simon's rain gauge. And the non-recording type rain gauge is most common type of rain gauge used by meteorological department. So it is the most common type of rain gauge used by the meteorological department, and consists of cylindrical vessels 127 mm in diameter with a base enlarged to 210 mm. So these are the dimension of that particular vessel where the rainfall will be collected for the measurement. And at its top section, the funnel is provided with circular brass rim, which is 127 mm exactly, so that it can fit into the vessel well. So there will be some circular brass rim which will be of the same diameter, so that it can easily fit into the mouth of the vessel well. And this funnel shank is inserted in the neck of a receiving bottle, which is 75 to 100 mm high. The receiving bottle is 75 to 100 mm high, and I hope you can see the same thing in this particular diagram. And 75 to 100 mm high from the base section and thinner than the cylinder placed into it to receive the rainfall. So this is the diagram of the Simon's rain gauge with graduated glass of accuracy 0.1 mm. A receiving bottle has capacity of 100 mm, and during heavy rainfall, amount of rain is frequently exceeded, so that the reading should be measured 3 to 4 times in a day. So what we do, we measure the readings 3 to 4 times a day. It is because the receiving bottle has capacity of 100 mm, and during the heavy rainfall, the amount sometimes gets exceeded. So therefore, we measure it for 3 to 4 times. So water content in the receiving bottle is measured by a graduated measuring glass with an accuracy of up to 0.1 mm. For uniformity, the rainfall is measured every day at 8:30 am at Indian Standard Time. So in India, we measured the rainfall at 8:30 am Indian Standard Time, and is recorded as the rainfall of the day. So what happens, the rain gauge is placed somewhere, it is installed somewhere, and the rainfall is collected simultaneously as and when the rainfall happens. And next, at 8:30 am, a person goes and checks what's the reading, and he will denote that this is the particular precipitation for the day, and this thing happens at 8:30 am only at Indian Standard Times. And with proper care, maintenance and inspection of the rain gauge, especially during dry weather, is necessary to keep the instrument free from dust and dirt. So this thing must be taken care that it should be free from dust and dirt, and so that the readings are accurate. And therefore, if it is free from the dust and dirt, the readings will be accurate. So if there is a presence of dust or dirt or some like other impurities, that won't give the exact measurement of what is the amount of water getting collected in that particular gauge or the collecting tube, whatever it is. Okay, so this was all about the Simon's rain gauge or the non-recording type rain gauge, but there is actually no setup for the recording of this particular rainfall, so therefore it is known as the non-recording type rain gauge. In the recording type rain gauge, there is some setup which will actually keep a record of what amount of rainfall is being followed. Previously the recording was manual, but in this way, the recording isn't manual. So there are three types of recording rain gauges, that is, the first is the weighing bucket type, next is the tipping bucket type, and third is the floating or the natural siphon type rain gauge. So in the weighing bucket type rain gauge, it is the most common self-recording rain gauge, most common if you consider the self-recording rain gauges. So this is the most common out of them, this weighing bucket type rain gauge. and it consists of a receiver bucket supported by a spring or lever balance or some other weighing mechanism. So there is a receiver bucket which is supported by some particular spring or lever and it has a weighing mechanism. The movement of a bucket due to its increasing weight is transmitted to a pen which traces the record of or some marking on a clock driven chart. So there is a bucket and whenever this rainfall is getting poured inside it, the rainfall is getting collected inside it, some weight will be accumulated over it and hence what will happen, this particular bucket will go down and therefore one pen which is adjusted with it and certainly one paper is also there, this pen will be marking on the paper and thus it will give you the measurement of the amount of rainfall that is taking place. So the weighing bucket type rain gauge instrument gives a plot of the accumulated increased rainfall values against the elapsed time and the curve so formed is called the mass curve. So this one graph will be formed on the paper as and when the water will be dripping, the water will be getting collected and the weight will be thus putting the vessel downwards and the pen attached to it will be making some marks on the paper and thus it will be somehow graphically in representation with respect to time, what is the amount of rainfall that is taking place, and thus this type of curve is known as the mass curve. So this is the diagram of this particular weighing bucket type rain gauge. Just go through it. Next is the tipping bucket type rain gauge, and tipping bucket type rain gauge is 30 cm size circular rain gauge adapted for use by US Weather Bureau. So this is mainly used by the US Weather Bureau and it has 30 cm diameter sharp edge receiver and at the end of the receiver is provided a funnel. And the pair of buckets are pivoted under this funnel in such a manner that when one bucket receives 0.25 mm of precipitation and it tips, discharging its rainfall into the container, bringing the other bucket under the funnel. So what happens whenever this rainfall will be collected in the bucket type arrangement, the water will be actually tipping down to the particular side and to the other bucket will be coming forward. So in this way we can also keep a record of what amount of water is being collected in the bucket and thus this will give us the reading for that particular amount of rainfall. Next thing is that the tipping of the bucket completes an electric circuit causing the movement of pen to mark on clock driven receiving drum which carries a recording sheet. So this is the diagram where this recording sheet is there and as and when that rainfall will be getting collected on that bucket, it will actually complete a circuit and due to that completion of the circuit, the pen which is over here, the pen which is over here will be making some marks on this particular drum and these marks will be our graphical representation of what amount of rainfall is taking place. And this electric pulses generated is recorded at the control room far away from the rain gauge station. This instrument is further suited for digitalizing the output signal. So this was about our tipping bucket rain gauge. Finally, we have the floating or natural siphon type rain gauge. The working of this type of rain gauge is similar to that of the weighing bucket rain gauge. A funnel receives the water which is collected in a rectangular container. A float is provided at the bottom of the container. So what is just one difference is there, that there is one float is being provided in this type of rain gauge and this float rises as the water level rises in the container. Its movement being recorded by a pen moving on a recording drum actuated by a clockwork. So previously what used to happen in the weighing bucket, whatever amount of water was being collected due to the weight, the bucket would go down and the pen attached to it would mark some graphs on the particular paper. Similar thing is that in this particular thing that water will be collected in a bucket, just the same mechanism is there. Only thing is that one float will be there. So whenever there the float is at the bottom of the tank or the bottom of the bucket, the pen will be at the starting point. So whenever the water will be, rainfall water will be poured inside it, what will happen? This float will rise as and when the water level will also rise. And with this particular rise, the pen will also keep on marking whatever amount of rainfall is being deposited inside it. And this particular graph which is being marked by this pen, it will give us the idea about the rainfall. So this is the image of this particular floating type rain gauge. This is the diagram. That's the rotating run, the pin point, and the funnel will be there, and this float will be marking everything in this particular rotating drum. And one more thing, this drum will be fixed and this will be actually rotating about one axis. So on its rotation, what will happen? This one will rotate somehow like this, and the pen will be marked like this over it. So one flat line will be drawn if there is no particular rainfall on when the drum will be getting rotated. But whenever there will be some rainfall and the float will rise, and simultaneously the drum will also rotate, what will happen? One particular graph will be drawn over it, and this graph will be giving us the idea about the mass curve of the rainfall in that area. When water rises, this float reaches to the top of the float, floating in water, and then siphon comes into operation and releases the water outwards through the connecting pipe. So what happens? The role of the siphon is now that whenever the water will be exceeding the limit, it will be siphoning it out. It will be actually throwing it out, the excess water, and then we can start our fresh reading from a new place. This rain gauge is adopted at the standard recording gauge in India. So this is the standard recording gauge in India, and the curve drawn by this, the curve drawn using the data is known as the mass curve of the rainfall. So as you know, this curve is the mass curve of rainfall. So next is the optimum number of rain gauges. So in a particular place, we install certain amount of rain gauges, dividing it into some subcatchments. So what we need to know that after the installation of those particular rain gauges, is those number of rain gauges sufficient enough to give us the idea about the average rainfall of that particular place? So that thing will be determined by using this particular theory about the optimum number of rain gauges, that whether this particular number of rain gauges are sufficient enough for us to denote whether it is giving us the correct value of precipitation or not. So if there are already some rain gauge stations in a catchment, the optimum number of stations that should exist to have an assigned percentage of error in the estimation of mean rainfall is obtained by statistical analysis as this formula. So it might happen like this, that you are allowing certain amount of error with this particular rain gauge, and you won't exceed that amount of error with the particular set of rain gauges that are installed in that particular catchment. So what happens? This formula gives us the idea about what shall be the optimum number of rain gauges that will give this much amount of error only. This epsilon is giving us what is the error, and CV will be the coefficient of, this thing is written over here. Anyhow, N is the number of optimal number of the rain gauges, that is N is the optimal number of rain gauges that we will be requiring for that particular place, and epsilon is the allowable degree of error in the estimation of the mean rainfall. So epsilon will be the error which we are expecting, but that this much error should be maximum, and beyond this there shouldn't be any error. And CV is the coefficient of variation of rainfall based on the existing in station in percentage. So it will be some coefficient of variation of rainfall based on the existing m number of stations, and m is that number of stations which are already existing in that particular area. And this CV, that is the coefficient of variation, can be obtained by this way, that is CV is equal to sigma upon x bar multiplied by 100, and sigma is our standard deviation and x bar is our mean of that particular set of readings by those particular rain gauges. So there is one question and we are going to do this question right now.
So let's read this particular question. So in this question, a catchment has 6 rain gauge stations and rainfall readings are shown as this 6 rainfall readings are given with this particular 6 rain gauge stations A, B, C, D, E, F. So what we are asked is that for a 10% error in the estimation of the mean rainfall, calculate the optimum number of stations in a catchment. So there is a 10% error in the particular estimation of the rainfall and we are asked to calculate the optimum number of stations required in this catchment. So first of all, we are given 6 stations. Just keep it in mind, we are given 6 stations. And secondly, what I will do is that I will arrange the data somehow like this. The data will be arranged somehow like this, that A, B, C, D, E, F are the stations. I will write them vertically and the rainfall, that is our XI according to the formula, and these are written like this. So let us now calculate the X bar. X bar will be XI by M. Suppose M is the total number of rain gauges and it is given by, so if I just add 82.6 plus 102.6, X bar will be given by 82.6 plus 102.6 plus 180.3 plus 110.3 plus 98.8 and plus it is 136.7 for the last rain gauge. 136.7. So this is our total sum and divided by 6 will give us the mean, and that is equal to, so dividing it with 6 will give us equal to 118.6 centimeter is our average rainfall. So I'll write 118.6 over here. So now in the next table I need to calculate XI minus X bar, and it will be calculated by, suppose for the first one it is 82.6, it is 82.6 minus our average is 118.6 and it is equal to minus 36. Okay, so similarly 102.6 minus 118.6 will give us 102.6 minus 118.6 will give us minus 16, and similarly I can get the values of all of them. So likewise, these are the values which I have got for the XI minus X bar for each of this particular reading, putting XI as this particular values minus the X bar, that is 118.6. Now in the next table, what I will do is that I will take a square of this particular terms. Like suppose minus 36, I have it over here, and in the next one I will take the square of minus 36, that is, and it is equal to 1296. So similarly, the square of 16 minus 16 will be 256, and so I will get the square root, a square of each and every term over here. So this is what I will be getting upon doing the square of this particular terms, and correspondingly I have written it over here. So now, so what I have done now, that I have added all of them together, and this is my summation of XI minus X bar whole square.
So what I will get is that standard deviation sigma is square root of summation of xi minus x bar whole square upon, it is given by m minus 1, where m is equal to 6, because we have 6 stations over here. So it is equal to square root of 6147.43 upon 6 minus 1, and thus I will get sigma equal to, I will get the standard deviation equal to 35.04 centimeter. So this is my standard deviation, that is equal to 35.04 centimeters, and therefore I will get now CV is equal to sigma upon x bar, and it is equal to 35.04 divided by 118.6. Sigma is, yes, x bar is 118.6 and sigma is 35.04, so I am just dividing this and multiply it with 100. So this will be my CV, and it is equal to 29.54 centimeters. So this is the value of my CV, that is the coefficient of variation. Finally, I'll have the calculation of n, I will have calculation of n, and that is equal to CV upon epsilon square. As you know, epsilon is the error, and CV is 29.54 divided by the epsilon, which is 10%, and I will now square it, and it is equal to 8.726, and I can take this value approximate to 9, right? So I'll have total 9 number of rain gauges for my catchment. So total 9 number of rain gauges will be optimum for my catchment. But in the problem you are seeing that there are 6 stations already available in the catchment. So how many more do we require? That is, we require 9 minus 6, that is equal to 3 more gauges for this particular catchment. Okay, so this was all about our question related to this optimum number of rain gauges which we require for our particular catchment, and for that we first arrange this data in a table, and then we try to calculate what are the required parameters. Like, we needed this thing xi minus x bar whole square, and to know the standard deviation, and also we came to know about the average first of all, and then using that standard deviation and average we calculated our coefficient of variation, with which we calculated our optimum number of rain gauges, and we got that 9 number of rain gauges were required. But in our question, as we were already provided with 6 rain gauges, so we required 3 more gauges to be installed. So this was about our question related to the optimum number of rain gauges, and this is a very practical question. Next is the estimation of rainfall data and estimation of missing rainfall data. If lot of records are there, lot of rainfall data is being recorded, and those records are being maintained. Sometimes it might happen due to some technical error or by human error that some rainfall data of a particular day or a particular period might get missed out. So to estimate, our system says that we do not have such problem like that. If some rainfall data is getting missed, so that is not a big problem. What we can do is that we can take some use some values which are already available to us, and with the help of that we can estimate the missing rainfall data. So this can be done by simple arithmetic average method and by method of weightage or normal ratio method. So let's quickly read about it. And in the simple arithmetic average method, This is simultaneous rainfall records of these three close by stations are made use of. So three close by stations are required and their simultaneous rainfall records are needed for that. And the station should however be evenly spaced around the station with missing records. So in which station the missing record will be there, the other two stations shall be evenly spaced with each other. So it's like that, if this station, this particular station has one data missing, for that particular time this station is also there and this station is also there. We will take up these two stations and these two stations will be such that these two are very close to each other and these are having some evenly spaced, that is they are equally spaced from the station in which the rainfall data is not there or the rainfall data is missing. The simple arithmetic average of the rainfall of the three selected stations gives the estimated of the missing value. So the simple arithmetic average will give the estimate of the missing value, and this method can be used to calculate monthly as well as annual missing rainfall values. So this method should be used only when the normal annual precipitation at each of the selected station is within 10% of that station of which records are missing. So this thing shall be taken care that normal annual precipitation at each of the selected stations should be within the 10% of that station for which the records are missing. It's not like that the two stations will have precipitations in some different values, like there will be some very huge difference between the two between the readings of those two stations. It shouldn't be like this. So next is the method of weightage or normal ratio method, and in this, when the normal annual rainfall of any of the selected station is more than 10% of that station within the missing records. So suppose in the previous thing we had made one condition for sure that the selected station should have rainfall data not more than 10% exceeding of the normal value. So it should be a maximum of error of plus minus 10% for the particular station which has the missing data. But if that value is exceeded by 10%, what we do is that we apply this method of weightage or normal ratio method. And for this, with missing record, simple average cannot be used, and then these methods to be adopted consist of weighing the rainfall value by the ratios of the normal annual rainfall values. To make the procedure clear, let X be a station with missing records and A, B and C are the three selected stations from homogeneous area. P is the rainfall value of certain period under consideration and N is the normal annual rainfall. So we have the normal annual rainfall, we have the rainfall value of certain period under consideration, and we have these three stations A, B, C. So suppose we want to know about the PX, the station X, we want to know the value. So it will be 1/3 of nx upon na multiplied by pa plus nx upon nb multiplied by pp plus nx upon nc multiplied by pc. So this will px upon nx will be given by this particular formula, where n and p are given respectively for each station. So like for na is the normal annual rainfall for station A, nb for station B and NC for station C, and PA is the precipitation value of that particular period in station A, PB for station B and PC for station C. So this method is quite useful in regions where large orographic variation occurs in precipitation. So like large orographic variation means like that in just one, from one area to other area, if you just go, you will see a large variation of rainfall. But in the previous case where we use only the simple arithmetic average method, that the stations will have not much difference of the values of rainfalls. So if the values of rainfall have much difference, then only we use the method of weightage or normal ratio method. So there is this question which will help us to understand this use of this normal ratio method, and this is that the calculate for station K the missing rainfall data for month of July 83 when the rainfall data for the other three stations J, P and N are available as follows. So
we need to calculate the missing data for July 83 for station K, whose normal annual rainfall is given as 26.2 centimeter, and for other three stations J, P and N, we have the normal annual rainfall and the July 83 rainfall given to us. So just we will use the simple formula that July 83 precipitation of K divided by the normal annual precipitation of K, and that will be equal to 1 by 3 Pj upon Nj plus Pp upon Np plus Pn upon Nn. So this will be equal to 1/3 of this thing. Just by putting the values, we will get the July 83 PPT of K as precipitation of K as 9.2 centimeter. So this is the way we can determine the missing rainfall data for a particular period of time. I hope this problem will be very clear to you, and this much will be the part that will be taught for this video lesson only. In the next part of the video lesson, we will continue with the part 2 of the precipitation, where we will read about the calculation of average rainfall, and we will learn about 3 different methods and about how to calculate using those 3 methods the average rainfall of a particular place. So till then, if you have any doubts, please do not hesitate to write in the comment section. And also I will say you that please like and share my video, also subscribe to the channel if you are new, and this subscription will be meaning a lot to me, and your subscription will give me a motivation for making such more good videos for you, and these videos in turn will be helpful for you for various competitions or various exams, or just to know about the particular topics. So thank you.